Welcome back to the second module of this course on community rights and forest governance. This lecture represents a milestone in this course. Let me explain why. We learned how governments control and determine how forests are used. They establish control by using the Indian Forest Act and the Wildlife Protection Act to restrict the rights of private persons, including local communities, to use forests. Forest departments of state governments administer the forests that they control in accordance with working plans. And governments follow the procedure set out under the Forest Conservation Act to use forest land for so-called non-forest purposes. Most of what we learnt was about how forests are governed in a centralized manner by state or central governments. We also noted, however, some spaces in these laws for local communities to influence how forests are used. And in the previous lecture, we learnt how some of those spaces are the result of their long-running struggle with the governments for their rights to live in and benefit from forests. In this course, we will learn about these spaces in more detail. So from observing how the use of forests is governed by governments from above, we are now moving to how people living in and around forests can participate in the governance of forests. One of the first recognized spaces for communities to participate in the governance of forests is the concept of village forest under the Indian Forest Act. Under that law, which even today is largely about the power of forest departments to control and to govern the use of forested land by declaring them to be reserve and protected forests, state governments can assign the rights that it has over any reserve forest to any village community. The rights that can be assigned in this manner are the rights of the state governments to govern the rights of settlement, cultivation, and harvesting of minor forest produce. Once such an assignment of rights happens, the forest land is called a village forest under the Indian Forest Act, and the village community can begin governing those rights. The village community's governance of those rights can be subject to rules made by the state government, regulating the management of village forests and prescribing conditions under which the community to which any such assignment is made may be provided with timber or other forest produce or pasture, and their duties for the protection and improvement of such forest. The government can also cancel such an assignment. Now, as we moved from the colonial period to independent India, one of the important factors supporting the argument for the increased participation of forest-dwelling communities, and particularly tribals, in the governance of forests, was the Constitution of India. While learning these constitutional provisions, you must keep in mind something we learnt in the first module of this course: the social, economic, and political marginalization of India's tribal communities. India's constitution sets out a protective framework for addressing this inequality.
The right to equality under our constitution has been clearly written down, not as one of formal equality, not as one that simply focuses on treating everybody equally and then leaving people to their own devices, but it's a substantive equality approach. There is a clear burden on the state and there is clear fundamental rights in the people that those who have been historically discriminated against, those who have been historically marginalized, must be provided with special protections, must be provided with special help from the state, which could be in the nature of special laws, it could be in the nature of special schemes, could be in the nature of even special protections at the cost of other communities, in order to ensure that these historical injustices are undone and to bring people to a place where we have equality of result. So the recognizing the fact that India is a country where there have been many histories of discrimination, not just against Adivasis in fact, but against many different other ethnic communities, Dalits, women, disabled people. So there is a recognition of a substantive equality approach. This substantive equality approach actually informs all the laws and all the legislations that have been created, and even the constitutional provisions themselves when they relate to the Adivasi communities and the Adivasi homelands. That's one part of it. Another very important aspect of the fundamental rights chapter is the notion of liberty. Under Article 19(1), there are many different liberties that have been granted to citizens of the country. And one of those, of course, is the liberty to freely move across the country, to freely undertake any work, to freely reside anywhere. It's very important to actually point out that under Article 19.5 of the Constitution, there is a reasonable restriction on this freedom with regard to scheduled tribes and scheduled areas. So there is a restriction on the liberty of the citizens of India with regard to their right to reside and their right to work and live in scheduled areas. So now let's come to the whole issue of scheduled areas. So Article 244 states that the fifth scheduled areas will be governed by the provisions in that schedule. The fifth scheduled areas are declared and actually were declared in 1950 by a presidential order. There are today 10 states in the country which have scheduled areas. They have special protections under the Constitution. And one of the most important aspects of the scheduled area concept in the Indian Constitution is that these areas, they foreground the rights over land and resources of the tribal populations in those areas, and even sometimes it may be at the cost of the non-tribal populations who may be living or working in those areas. And this is a very important constitutional protection that has been given to tribal homelands, because across the colonial period and even in the post-colonial period, egregious examples are there of non-tribal populations entering into tribal areas, taking hideous advantage of their simplicity, their lack of knowledge of how the legal systems and how paperwork happens, and taking control of tribal lands by simply making a fool out of the tribal peoples, and then actually converting those tribal populations into bonded labor or all kinds of other kind of oppressions that take place, financial and social oppressions. So the constitution makers, and subsequent to that, the independent India's parliament recognized that there is a need to protect tribal homelands and the right to land and resources in tribal areas, which are defined under the constitution as scheduled areas.
The president of India has the power to declare any area of India as a scheduled area, and through some presidential orders, some areas of the country were declared scheduled areas. Most of these were the Adivasi regions of India that had been classified as excluded or partially excluded territories during the British colonial rule, and which had been ruled directly by the governors of provinces. Now, under the fifth schedule of the Constitution of India, the governors of states containing any of these areas, among their other powers in relation to scheduled areas, can repeal or amend any central or state law applicable to such an area or modify their application. States with scheduled areas would also have tribes advisory councils to advise on the welfare and advancement of the state's scheduled tribes. Many governments have used these constitutional provisions to pass laws with special protections for tribal communities.
So there are two aspects of the statutory laws and the statutory law regime relating to scheduled areas that we have to remember, which is really important with regard to land and resources. The first is that as per paragraph 5 of the fifth schedule, the lands of Adivasis in scheduled areas have to be protected from alienation to non-tribals. And every single state which has a scheduled area, and in fact many states which don't have scheduled areas and have a significant tribal populations also, have in place state level legislations which strictly prohibit or regulate the transfer of tribal lands to non-tribals. And this is a very, very important statutory protection. It is unfortunate that even till today, these laws are being followed in the breach. Many examples are there of in spite of the fact that these protective legislations are there, lands are being transferred to non-tribals by taking permission from the deputy commissioners or the district collectors or through other means which are not legal. But the fact remains that these laws are continuing to be in place. It's important to also remember that many of these legislations were actually challenged in various constitutional courts by non-tribals on the grounds that they violate the right to equality. And those judgments that have emerged, whether they be from the Bombay High Court or from the Andhra Pradesh High Court or even other high courts, those judgments in one voice actually say that there is no violation of the right to equality. And far from a violation, in fact, these protective legislations are an important part of the substantive equality approach to Adivasi populations in our country. So that's one very important area in which the law protects the rights of Adivasi communities in scheduled areas and also in some cases outside scheduled areas. The second very important part is the governance of Adivasi areas. And one interesting change that the fifth schedule makes is that the governor has been given a very important status inside scheduled areas. His role as a governor normally is to work act on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. However, when he takes decisions within scheduled areas, he is entitled to act on his own discretion, on his own knowledge and understanding, and he can actually on occasion act contrary to the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers when it relates to laws which are required for the peace and good government inside scheduled areas. So the fifth schedule actually gives the governor the power to either stop the operation of certain state and central legislations in scheduled areas or to modify their operation in scheduled areas. Of course, it's unfortunate that the governors in the last 70 years have not even attempted to utilize this very, very important constitutional power that they have. I can only think of one example in recent years when the governor of Maharashtra at one point of time took several very important steps and passed very important regulations and exercise of his powers under the fifth schedule to modify the operation of certain central legislations, including the Environment Protection Act to scheduled areas and in Maharashtra, including requiring, say for instance, the consent of the Gram Sabha before giving a consent to operate to a polluting industry. So these are very, very interesting, but these are rare examples of how the governor has utilized these powers.
Another important development took place in the 1990s when India modified the application of its local self-government laws for scheduled areas. The 73rd and 74th amendments added two new parts to the constitution, Part 9 titled The Panchayats and Part 9A titled The Municipalities. 29 subjects were transferred to the panchayats and 18 to the municipalities. Within a year of the act coming into force, the states were to make suitable modifications to their laws to be in conformity with those amendments.
The 73rd amendment clearly excluded the 5th and 6th schedule areas, for which the parliament was supposed to make separate enactments. These exemptions were to be in consonance with Article 243M of the Constitution. For the tribal dominated states that do not fall under the 5th and 6th schedules, there was special constitutional protection with greater autonomy. For instance, for Nagaland under Article 371A and Mizoram under Article 371G. Local self-government in India means units of government below the state governments that govern with autonomy over some matters. The only mention of local self-government in the Constitution of India was in Article 40, in a non-enforceable directive principle of state policy, which said, "The state shall take steps to organize village panchayats and endow them with such powers and authority as may be necessary to enable them to function as units of self-government." In 1992, the 73rd Amendment added Part 9 of the Constitution titled the Panchayats. It created across India three tiers of panchayats at the village, intermediate and district levels, and set out the framework for how states could constitute them. In addition, it also recognized Gram Sabhas. Gram Sabhas are bodies comprising all the people registered in the electoral rolls relating to a village within the area of a single panchayat at the village level. Within a year of the amendment, all states were expected to modify their laws to remove any conflict with Part 9. Some parts of the country, however, were specifically excluded from the application of the provisions of Part 9. They would not apply to the so-called scheduled areas until the Parliament specifically made a law extending these provisions with necessary modifications to those areas.
The Panchayat's Extension to Scheduled Areas Act 1996, or PESA, was the law made by Parliament for this purpose. It extended the provisions of Part 9 of the Constitution to the scheduled areas and the nine states that contained these areas, namely Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Himachal Pradesh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Orissa, and Rajasthan. These states were to enact laws to comply with Part 9 read with the PESA.
The other aspect of governance is that in 1996, Parliament enacted the Panchayats Extension to Scheduled Areas Act. Now, again, very often it's misunderstood that PESA is simply an act of Parliament. But actually, if you look at the Panchayats Extension to Scheduled Areas Act, it's a constitutional mandate under Article 243 ZC, which clearly states that the provisions of the Constitution and state legislations relating to panchayats will not extend to scheduled areas. And then goes on to say that if panchayats are extended to scheduled areas, they can only be done through a law which specifically provides the modifications under which these laws will be extended. So this is a very important law, and whenever we argue in favor of the PESA, or we use PESA in court or even outside court, we're very careful to draw the connection between PESA and the Constitution and the fact that there is a constitutional mandate under which PESA has been enacted. Without PESA, we could actually not have panchayats operating in scheduled areas at all. So that's an important thing to remember. So what really is PESA? PESA is a very brief legislation. It's very simple. It's very clearly drafted. And it has a short number of provisions, very pointed, very sharp. Some people find that it's difficult to operationalize PESA because of its brevity. But actually, I have found that the fact that PESA is a short, sharp legislation has been its strength, because it has been a legislation that immediately upon being enacted was translated into many, many, many local languages, including tribal languages, circulated widely across the country in tribal as well as non-tribal areas. And the tribal movements as well as the tribal communities have taken ownership of this law because they find it very easy to understand. Sometimes I feel that laws like PESA and Forest Rights Act are difficult for people like us to understand, because we come from a very different socio-political context. Our conditioning is very different, so we find these laws very difficult to understand. But for tribal communities, it's very, very easy to understand.
Unlike the provisions of Part 9, the PESA clearly gave a central role to Gram Sabhas. Every habitation or a group of habitations or a hamlet or a group of hamlets comprising a particular community and managing its affairs in accordance with traditions and customs must have a separate Gram Sabha.
It recognized several powers of the Gram Sabha, including its powers to safeguard and preserve the traditions and customs of the people, their cultural identity, community resources, and the customary mode of dispute resolution, manage minor water bodies, and approve plans for projects taken up for implementation at the panchayat level. Consultation with the Gram Sabhas was made mandatory for the acquisition of any land for development projects and before the resettlement or rehabilitation of project-affected people in those areas. No prospecting license, mining lease, or concession for the exploitation of minor minerals can be granted in scheduled areas without the recommendation of the Gram Sabha or panchayats at the appropriate level. The Gram Sabhas are also the owners of minor forest produce. Both Gram Sabhas and panchayats at the appropriate level have the power to prevent the alienation of land in scheduled areas and to take action to restore illegally alienated land. The PESA also instructs states to make laws that will make it clear that the powers of the self-government bodies at the lower levels, including the Gram Sabha, are not encroached upon by the bodies at higher levels.
The Gram Sabha is the entire body of adult members of a particular village. All the members together of that village constitute what is the Gram Sabha. So the Gram Sabha in a sense is the community itself. The Gram Panchayat is actually the elected body, which you know would be the sarpanch and whoever the ward members, etc., the up sarpanch and so on. They're the elected members. They constitute the Gram Panchayat. So in a sense, it's the executive body. The important thing to remember for scheduled areas is that very often under the state Panchayati Raj laws, the area which is delimited for a Gram Panchayat area, from where the election happens to the Gram Panchayat, constitutes several villages. In fact, we have examples from places like Himachal where there may be 12 to 15 revenue villages which constitute one Gram Panchayat area. So under the PESA, this kind of Gram Sabha will not work, and it cannot work. So you can't have 1,000 people sitting together and taking decisions on what happens to their resources. They'll spend all their time fighting with each other. So that is why the PESA makes this very important departure from existing Panchayati Raj laws at the state level, which is that the Gram Sabha has to be constituted either at the hamlet level or at the lowest, smallest habitation level, so that you have very, very small and intrinsically sort of connected communities which form one Gram Sabha.
So the PESA distributes powers of governance to the level of the village. Let's quickly learn some of the powers that Gram Sabhas have under this law.
The PESA gives ownership rights to Adivasis over minor forest produce, and it also talks about securing tribal culture. A very important feature of this act is around the provisions of land acquisition. We have seen that before, and especially after independence, large tracts of tribal areas have been diverted and displaced in the name of development. In this whole process of displacement, either for dams or mines or roads and highways, there were no provisions for people's consent. In a real sense, people were displaced without their consent. In 1996, for the first time, when the concept of Gram Sabha came in force, it kind of recognized the tribal culture of collective decisions. This concept actually reinforced the spirit of local self-governance for which the Panchayati Raj system was formalized.
And going on from there, the PESA also then lays down various other areas on which the Gram Sabha has control. It has decision-making power. For instance, the PESA says requires that minor forest produce in the area will be under the ownership of the Gram Sabha. It talks about how minor water bodies will be under the control and management of the Gram Sabha. It talks about how minor minerals, before they are allocated to any private entity or even to a state entity, the consent of the Gram Sabha is required. And one very important provision in PESA, which actually to my mind is more important than all these put together, is the fact that before there is any kind of developmental activity in that area, the Gram Sabha has to be consulted. Now, there is a very unfortunate formulation of this provision in PESA, which I think even the people who drafted it didn't realize that they were leaving a very important loophole in the law, where the law says that it is the Gram Sabha or the Panchayat at the appropriate level. Now, I think that at that point of time, they must have thought that if it's a very large project or it's a project that affects a number of communities at the same time, then it will not be just simply the Gram Sabha, but it will also be the maybe the Panchayat Samiti at the subdivision level and the Zilla Parishad at the district level, which will also be consulted. Unfortunately, state governments have interpreted this provision to mean that they can consult any of the Panchayati Raj institutions. And I'll give you an example from the state of Orissa. When they made the necessary amendments to their state Panchayati Raj legislations, they actually have put in a provision which is completely unconstitutional and ultra vires according to me, where they have stated that consultation will be with the Zilla Parishad in case of any development activities. Actually, that kind of provision in their statutory law makes no sense at all. It is completely contrary to what PESA sets out to do. It has to be consultation with the Gram Sabha, and most state governments actually have recognized the fact that the consultation will be with the Gram Sabha.
Many official bodies and experts have monitored the implementation of the PESA. In 2008, the Second Administrative Reforms Commission said that while all the fifth scheduled areas have enacted laws to comply with the PESA, those provisions give the powers of the Gram Sabha to other bodies. For example, in Andhra Pradesh, the Gram Sabhas have no role in the acquisition of land for development projects. Gujarat assigned this power to the Taluka Panchayat and Orissa assigned it to the Zilla Panchayat with no role for the Gram Sabha. Even though technically all such laws have automatically become invalid after the enactment of the PESA, they are still being followed by the state government machinery. Now that we have learned the powers of the Gram Sabhas under the special legal provisions applicable to the scheduled areas under the Indian Constitution, let us move ahead to the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act 2006, which is commonly known as the Forest Rights Act. We will learn that in the next lecture. Thanks for watching.